and the first one to be worth $10 billion. Sherry Preston, ABC News.
1380 WPHM Blue Water News. The WPHM News with Paul Miller on 1380 WPHM.
Here I am, on the road again. There I am, up on the stage. Here I go, playing star again. There I go, turn the page.
Well, it's time for our police chief to turn the page, and you turn the page, and it's the end of the chapter. It's time for a new chapter to begin for Joe Platzer. Chief, good morning.
Good morning, Paul.
Well, we've been talking about this for months now. You made your announcement last winter or spring, I think, that you'd be leaving this year.
Yeah, it was in
year.
The springtime.
Yeah. So now it comes down to just a matter of days, huh?
I have 2 days left, so I'll be there in the office on Thursday. And then Sunday I'll be working the last unofficial float down. And then Sunday evening when I walk out of there, it'll conclude 36 years of service to the city of Port Huron.
Wow. So you're ending your service to the city of Port Huron with float down. How about that?
Yeah. I told the assistant chief and captain that I would work one more, that I got one more in me. And so I'll be working Sunday.
Well, I mean, the assistant chief is here, Brian Kerrigan. Brian, good morning.
Good morning.
And Lieutenant Nick Godwin. Nick, good morning.
Good morning, Paul.
And you need all hands on deck for float down, don't you?
Yeah, definitely. You never know what you're going to get on float down. Sometimes it's pretty mild, and sometimes, depending on the weather, it can turn into chaos pretty quick.
Yeah, and you've seen all different kinds of float downs over the years, haven't you?
I was the road sergeant when we had the first real official incident. Where people were coming out of the pilot house, and after that, we were unprepared for that evening, and we are now well prepared. Lieutenant Godwin does a great job with our ops plan throughout the year, and we couldn't do it without all our local, federal, state partners.
Well, before we finish, we'll kind of remind people some of the things they need to keep in mind for this weekend. Let's talk a little bit about your career. When did you know that you wanted to go into law enforcement, Chief?
I'll tell you, probably about the age 5 or 6. Excuse me. My dad was a police officer of the city of Port Huron. I seen what he did for a living, and my mom and dad actually bought me a police uniform, and my neighbors to this day still remind me about going around the neighborhood writing them parking tickets on my bicycle.
That's fantastic.
So at a very young age, I saw what my dad did. I'm like, that's what I want to do.
And you got involved as young as you can. You started with the Explorer program, right?
14 years old, I was an Explorer with the St. Clair County Sheriff's Office. Port Huron Police Department did not have an Explorer post at that time. I spent 6 years with the Sheriff's Office. At age 18, I was hired as a police cadet from then Captain Wagner. And in 1991, Chief Corbett gave myself, Karen Brisby, and Tom Rudicelli an opportunity, and I was hired as a police officer.
It's it blows my mind to see you guys retiring, because I remember, you know, when you joined the force, essentially. So for me, I'm watching saying, how is this even possible? It goes by quick, doesn't it?
It does, and that's what I've been telling everybody. I sat in my office the other day, and I was looking out the window, and I don't know where 36 years went to. Just like we're talking right now, I remember my time in the Explorers, being a cadet, being sworn in as an officer, all my promotions, being time out in the MCU, the Major Crimes Unit, Special Response Team, and then, a little over six years ago, City Manager Freed gave me the opportunity to become chief, and it's been a great ride, and I've just been telling everybody, enjoy it. Take notes, because when you're done, sit back and write a book. Because some of the stuff that we see and do and hear, it's definitely book worthy.
I bet it is. I can't wait to read that book. Do you have any stories you can share with us this morning, good, bad, or otherwise, that just kind of stand out as you look back on your career, things that you'll always remember?
Well, when Karen Brisby retired, her and I went through the academy. We became great friends. We were beat partners, and I rolled with her on her last day. And we just drove around the city going, hey, remember this call, remember that call. And we were driving by one house, and she just says, hey, do you remember the night we answered a domestic here, and it was snowing out, and as we were approaching the house, I fell in a snowbank. And as I was continuing, I didn't know where my partner was, so I looked back, and there's Karen laying in the snowbank, laughing like there was no tomorrow. And here we are trying to be serious, answering a domestic call, and Karen's laying in a snowbank, because she fell on some ice or whatever. But So, I mean, just one of those. And, I mean, there's tragedies, but there's more good times than there were bad times.
Let's see if these guys have any chief stories they want to tell. Brian, anything that comes to mind when you think about your years working with Joe Plantzer?
I don't know if I should tell any until after after Sunday when I won't get in trouble for it. But, no, it's been great working with him. I worked with him on a major crimes unit, so we put a lot of good cases, a lot of long hours in, and learned a lot from him, so it's really good.
Nick?
Well, I got to know Joe a little bit when I was also an explorer, about 14, going up to Camp Grayling and seeing him as a drill instructor. And so I've been around Joe for a bit also. But just his outpouring support for the community, for the department, it's always been Port Huron first. And whatever he can do to help take care of the officers, if there's equipment that they need to do their job more efficiently to help serve the community, it's just it's really been focused on community, department, family first.
This is a department that has always seemed to have had a great succession plan in place. In other words, a lot of people have, you know, risen through the ranks and have advanced, and you're just a prime example of that.
Yeah, Chief Corbett, like I say, I got to give him all the credit. He gave an opportunity to three people back in 1991, and he was a great mentor of mine, along with my dad and several other people, Diana Tramsky, Neil Rosso, Tom Carr from the St. Clair County Sheriff's Office, and the list could go on and on and on. But, yeah, the succession planning is huge, because when I walk out of the department Sunday night, the department's going to continue. And the nice thing knowing is that we've got great people in place that's going to continue to move the department forward, and it's not going to stop just because Joe Plantzer retired. So that's the nice thing about our agency, how we do things. And I know it'll continue in the future. You know, the leaders coming up, the leaders that we have in place, we'll do the citizens of Port Huron very well.
Have you thought yet about what that's going to feel like on Monday morning when you get to wake up, when you want to wake up and do what you want to do during the day?
It's going to be weird because I've been attached to a phone, or back in the day, a pager, and not having to look at the phone every 5 minutes to see what emails came in or what phone call I missed. It's going to take some time to readjust or adjust. But like I told the officers, I'll be their biggest supporter. I'm their biggest fan. I'm through and through PHPD, and don't be surprised if they're on a traffic stop somewhere and I roll up in my personal car just to make sure that they're safe out there.
I bet that'll happen indeed. Brian, what has the chief instilled in you as you move forward in your career?
I was going to say one thing to that last. We kind of have office back going on whether he's going to walk in Monday morning still, but
I bet you see him sometime Monday.
Be like, oh, yeah, I forgot. Just that routine, right?
Right.
No, you know, he's shown, you know, obviously Joe's always been there. He's on duty 24 hours a day and, you know, takes the responsibility seriously and makes sure that the department's prepared and that, you know, we show up and we handle things and we do it the right way every time and that kind of stuff. So always focused on training, always focused on doing it the right way and being available, and it's going to be some big shoes to fill.
Well, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, you hang around long enough, you observe what people that have been there before you have done, and you find that you learn things along the way. Huh?
That is a huge key. You know, the chief gives me a lot of credit for things that I do, but it's the people who came before me. You know, Sergeant Decker, Chief Larry David, and the list goes on and on before them that we learn from those before us. They do a phenomenal job, and we take those lessons and try to just keep improving it. And the next generation does the same. The next generation does the same. So the department, the community can keep improving.
It's always weird that day that you wake up and you realize, oh, I'm one of the people that I'm now teaching things to, and you see that there's younger you know, folks coming up that you're able to instill things in as well. We did mention Float Down coming up this Sunday. You work all year to put a plan in place for the day. What are things that you want people to be mindful of for Sunday?
Well, you know, we talked about it last week, but can't stress the importance of a life jacket. Having a life jacket if you decide to go in the river. Really check out the forecast. It doesn't seem like it's going to be a great day to be floating down the river, so make that decision. Have that in your decision-making parts to decide whether to partake or not. Have a plan, whether you're where you're parking your vehicles. Make sure you're not parking in no parking areas or somebody's driveway or across the boulevard, because if we have to, we'll ticket, and if we have to tow, we'll tow. We don't want to do that. So just be respectful. Park in areas where you should. I see the sign here. This is a great reminder of please keep the river clean. I see a lot of trash going down the river, people with jello shots or cans or whatever. Please just take a bag with you. Throw that stuff inside, because we don't want to pollute the river just because it's a fun day. We can have fun and be responsible about it. So please limit the alcohol, and definitely have a mode of propulsion, whether it's fins, a paddle, something to keep you where you want to be and not maybe over in another country.
All right, very good. Maybe going out on float down is not a bad way to go out, because you'll be at the end of the day and say, that's it, I'm done, I'm not coming back.
That's it. We'll have a good day on Sunday, and then, like I say, I'll be turning the reins over. And just I'd like to thank you, Paul, and everybody here at the radio station, Caleb and Matt and Scott. You've been a great partner. You've called me many times and said, hey, what's going on? And we've been able to have those conversations, and you've always been a great reporter, and I appreciate that. I'd like to thank the citizens of Port Huron for their continuous support and their support over the years. We've got a great community. We've got a great city council, mayor, city manager that supports the police department. And I say thank you. And I want to thank all the men and women of the Port Huron Police Department. Those are the true heroes. Those are the ones that are out right now answering calls for service, going without lunches or dinners, and keeping the citizens of Port Huron safe. And I want the citizens to know that they've got the best police department in the state, and they're well-trained. They come into work every day wanting to do the job, and I could be more proud of my staff and the up-and-coming leaders of the department. So I say thank you.
Chief, thank you for your years of service to the city of Port Huron. Enjoy your retirement. Any day that you happen to be driving around, and you want to stop at Chef Shell's and then stop over here, the door's always open. So
I told the next person, whoever that's going to be, they got some shoes to fill there with the donuts. You look forward to it every time that I come in. So
absolutely.
At least four times a year. So.
Very good. Chief, thanks again, guys. Thanks so much for being here. Really appreciate it.
Thanks,
Brian Kerrigan, along with Nick Godwin. It is 8:21 here on WPHS.
Nights on 1380 WPHL.
Your local home for Detroit Tigers baseball is News Talk and Sports, 1380 WPHM.
2-2, swinging the fly ball down the right field line. It's deep, it's got a chance, and it's gone, a home run. Number 10 for Colt Keith. 8-1 Tigers in the ninth.
Brought to you by A. Webster Sewer and Drain Cleaning, Valley Well and Pump, St. Clair County Health Department, Rock and Wood Supply Yard, Stewart Adams and Sons Heating and Cooling, Frazier Building Company, and the Murphy Inn.
The biggest newsmakers live on your radio weekdays at 10 a.m. Hi, everyone. I'm Brian Kilmeade. Tune in to my show right here on 1380 WPHM.
ABC News, I'm Sherry Preston. Tropical storm Ernesto strengthening as it swings north of Puerto Rico. Winds about 60 miles an hour. People are being warned to stay out of the ocean. Puerto Rico's main energy provider is asking people to call if they detect outages. The U.S. continues working to get ceasefire talks going again in the Middle East. That as Israel braces for a possible attack from Iran, the State Department approving $20 billion in new weaponry sales to Israel. Ukrainian troops continue their offensive into Russia. ABC Chief Foreign Correspondent Ian Pannell has more.
Another region of Russia declaring a state of emergency over Ukraine's audacious operation across the border. Overnight, the governor of the border region of Belgorod calling the situation very difficult following attacks by Ukrainian forces, saying houses are destroyed, civilians dead and injured. Belgorod, of course, being used to launch consistent deadly attacks on Ukraine.
ABC's Ian Paddle. This is ABC News.
Chief Green. The St. Clair County Drug Task Force is celebrating the arrest of five people in connection with two separate investigations into the sale of methamphetamine last week in Port Huron. Tuesday, 36-year-old Matthew Fields and 21-year-old Kaylee Rattage of Port Huron were taken into custody at a home in the 1000 block of 7th Street following a raid. The pair were allegedly found in possession of a dealer's quantity of crystal meth and various materials used in distribution. And on Thursday night, a traffic stop on eastbound I-94 near Water Street resulted in the arrest of 41-year-old Victoria Urey, 37-year-old Jessica DeBron, both of Port Huron, and 70-year-old Jason Swinson of Clyde. The three are being charged with the delivery and or possession of methamphetamine. In total, more than 20 grams of narcotics were seized over the 2 days. McLaren Hospital is providing an update following recent cyber attacks. In a statement this week, the hospital chain says although emergency departments are fully operational, some locations are still diverting ambulances to other area hospitals for certain conditions. But the comprehensive stroke centers in Flint and Macomb are no longer impacted by the attacks. The same is being said for all Carmanis Cancer Institute facilities across the state. McLaren says Cancer Institute patients whose appointments were delayed should expect a call soon from their care team. Primary and specialty care offices are now largely open, but down IT systems could still be causing longer than average wait times. And if you've ever wanted to take a tour of a working fire station, tomorrow's your chance. The Port Huron Fire Department is opening the doors of their brand new central fire station for an open house. Fire Chief Corey Nicholson described what's in store for attendees.
We'll be giving tours of the facility. The firefighters will be giving tours to the public. There'll be a kids zone, some refreshments. I believe there's some ice cream stands lined up. And one of the highlights will be Terry Ernst is actually in possession of our 1924 American LaFrance. So it is a 100-year-old fire engine that will be on display.
The event runs from 5 p.m. until 7 at Fire Station 1 on 10th Street. Details on these stories and more can be found online at WPHM.net. I'm Steve Green for the Blue Water News Network.
The future depends on teachers. Every day, teachers are shaping our tomorrows, starting their students on journeys that will change the course of history. Right now, in a classroom somewhere in the United States, there's a teacher inspiring a future scientist who will make preventing pandemics their life's work, sharpening the mind of an aspiring environmentalist who will help combat climate change, and generating possibilities for a student who will be the first in their family to graduate college. It all starts with teachers who meet challenges with creativity, who reinvent education for the future, who work towards a school system that lifts up every child, regardless of race, income, or zip code, and to enable the full potential of our students, our communities, and our country. Explore a career that leaves a legacy you can be proud of. Shape the future. Teach. Learn more and receive free support at teach.org.
News, talk, and sports with Paul Miller continues from the Kitchen Tune-Up Studios on 1380 WPHM.
All right, 8:40 on this Wednesday morning. I don't think we realize how lucky we are when it comes to weather in this particular region. We've really had, we've had some hot spells here and there, but for the most part, pretty mild summer. And last year's summer was not only mild, but really cool at times. That's not the case everywhere, and the EPA is looking into some what they call urban heat islands now, some very deadly places for heat. Joining us right now from Dallas, ABC News correspondent Jim Ryan. Jim, good morning.
Good morning, Paul. Last year, Dallas, for example, joined Salt Lake City, Oklahoma City, Sedona, Arizona, and others in something called the Urban Island Mapping Campaign, something that NOAA has come up with, to try to determine what parts of individual cities are hotter than other parts. And yes, there are about 10 urban islands of heat in Dallas alone. In some places, it's 10 degrees hotter than it is in other parts of the city on the same day. A lot of it has to do with architecture. It has to do with buildings. Downtown urban areas generally are hotter because air doesn't move as well, and the sunlight is reflected down onto the street from the buildings. You also have urban areas that are paved, you know, the freeways and highways and parking lots that generate heat. They collect heat from the sun, they hold it in, and then they release it later on in the day. So people complain about the heat, but they're not doing much about it, or are they? there are plans in the works now, Paul, to try to address some of these urban heat areas in places like Dallas, Houston, and Los Angeles.
Obviously, we know that climate change has something to do with the overall temperature rising, but you make a good point that things as simple as architecture and infrastructure can add to that heat, can't it?
Well, absolutely. And so reversing the heat issue means reversing some of those problems. Roofing materials now. There are reflective roofing materials which are intended to keep the rooftops cooler. Reflective or less heat-generating surfaces for roadways and highways. Unfortunately, those overlays have to be put onto roads that are in pretty good condition. If not, they just don't adhere. And then there are tree projects, planting trees in various areas where temperatures have been found to be higher. Planting trees helps to cool down individual neighborhoods. If you drive through a neighborhood, Paul, and it has old trees that line the street, you notice how much cooler it is. So trying to generate that kind of activity in hot weather areas can help.
This excessive heat doesn't just cause discomfort, but it can cause serious health issues, can't it?
Well, absolutely. Just here in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, 20 people died last year of heat-related illnesses. We saw what happened down in Houston when a hurricane just last month took out electricity to tens of thousands of people, and there were people who died in the heat from that. So, yeah, it's not just an inconvenience. It's not just uncomfortable. It can be serious, can be deadly.
Yeah, absolutely, and it needs to be addressed, and is through these studies. These urban heat islands, as they're being called, obviously, right now it's at the studying point, but there are plans, it sounds like, to really address this with some new infrastructure, and as you said, maybe trees and things like that as well.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And just finding the data is interesting. I think, you know, they have armies of people who go out with the heat guns or with thermometers to measure the temperature in various areas. In Chicago, they release balloons, small balloons that take heat sensing devices up to map out specific areas. So, you know, just finding the hotter areas in individual cities is interesting. And then trying to find a way to reverse some of that. There are methods out there that have proven effective, Paul.
All right. Fascinating stuff. Jim, appreciate your reporting. Thanks so much.
All right. Thanks, Paul.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye. 1380 WPHM in Port Huron, Jim Ryan from ABC News. I'm telling you, we are lucky here that when it gets hot, it doesn't stay hot for weeks on end. When it gets hot, what have we hit, maybe 90 once or twice this summer? We're not talking triple digits. Out west, I realize it's a dry heat, you know, when you get to Arizona, Nevada, etc. But it's still excessive heat, and they've been dealing with it a lot over the last few years. Around here, our weather is pretty mild by comparison. Let's take a look at the forecast in just a moment. Oh, real quick, want to remind you that there's a serious traffic situation along westbound I-94 down around the county line, and you're going to see traffic backups. Advise maybe try Gratiot as an alternate if you're heading down into southern St. Clair County along I-94, making your way down toward Metro Detroit. Again, a couple of semis involved in a very serious accident along westbound I-94 at the county line. All right, let's take a quick look at weather now.
WPHM. Live and local every morning, you're listening to Paul Miller on WPHM.
All right, here we go. 5 minutes before the top of the hour in news from ABC and the Michigan News Network, all your local news of the day. We do have a traffic note to pass along this morning. Westbound I-94 at Wadhams Road is closed. Again, that's westbound 94 at Wadhams, closed because of a bad accident involving a semi. Police, EMS, hazmat all on the scene. Asking that you seek another route. Gratiot would be a good way to route around that. But again, Wadhams Road westbound I-94, I'm sorry, not Wadhams Road, but westbound I-94 at Wadhams is closed due to an accident. Probably will be for some time. News on the way, and after the news, we're going to talk about the Wounded Warrior Project. National Nonprofit Day is coming up this weekend, and time to recognize the powerful role that business nonprofit partnerships can play. The Wounded Warrior Project partners with a lot of organizations around the country to help reach, enhance, and expand programs to improve advocacy efforts for post-9/11 injured veterans and their families. Tell you more about that coming up in just a few minutes here on WPHM.
It's Brian Kilmeade.
Joe Biden feels as though he lost control of that court. They are trying to destabilize another institution and make it something to run on. And you're going to see Kamala Harris saying that the Supreme Court reform is something we got to do. And if they find a way to win the presidency, and if they find a way to get the majority in the Senate or retain it, look for them to do something really big in terms of packing the court and trying to negate its power.
Weekdays, 10 a.m. to noon on 1380 WPHM and the WPHM free mobile app.
The traditional light bulb, a groundbreaking invention in 1879. Other groundbreaking ideas from that time, the whalebone corset, the pedal-operated submarine, and the two-story outhouse. We've come a long way since then. It's time our light bulbs did the same. Visit energysavers.gov and learn about energy-saving light bulbs. See, these new bulbs are more efficient than the old ones, like a text message is more efficient than a carrier pigeon. They last longer, too, like how we humans last longer now that doctors use antibiotics instead of leeches. And they cut down on our energy costs, because in our own groundbreaking age of aeroplanes and moving pictures, we deserve a light bulb that saves us some cash. Saving energy saves you money. Learn more at energysavers.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Energy and the Ad Council.
Lee Habib here, host of Our American Stories. For 5 years, our show has been heard weeknights on 1380 WPHM, but now we're expanding our show and bringing it to our Blue Water area listeners for 2 hours every weekday afternoon. On our show, we celebrate the founding fathers, authors, artists, sports legends, and great entrepreneurs. New stories at a new time now every afternoon from 1 to 3 p.m. on News Talk and Sports 1380 WPHM.
The Tom Sullivan Show.
It's going to come down to, if you're a Democrat and you believe in Democrat ideas, you're going to go with the Democrat that you got. If you're a Republican and you believe in Republican ideas, you're going to go with the Republican you got. That's what it's going to come down to. I don't think either one of these two are, I don't like either one of them. I just don't. But that's me. I'm grumpy.
Tom Sullivan, 3 to 6 p.m. on News Talk and Sports, 1380 WPHM.
At Doctors Without Borders, we put patients first. And we go where we're needed most. We believe people deserve to be treated with compassion and dignity. We treat our patients completely free of charge and without regard to race, religion, or politics. And thanks to the 6 million people around the world who support our work, Doctors Without Borders will continue to put our patients first.